So many reasons to fall in love. So many reasons for the moon up above. So many reasons for you and I. We'll be together until we die. So many reasons for the wind to blow. So many reasons for the rivers to flow. All of these reasons are sweet mystery. Now that I love you and you love me, we will never fall apart the way some people do. We will always tell each other, I'm still in love with you.
I love you, Ernest.
I love you, Ernestine.
I love you. Because you're in your own sweet little world.
I love you because you have pizzazz for just walking down the street.
I love you because you make me feel like Juliet.
Who?
Juliet? Romeo and Juliet from literature.
Okay.
I love you because you make me want to blush, and I don't know why.
I love you because you make me want to marry you.
I love you because I knew you'd say that. I love our basement home, Ernest.
It's like a dream, Ernestine.
Oh.
It's so warm. Snug as a rug and a bug. Snug as two rugs,
oh.
Two bugs, a huggin'.
I can't believe I'm gonna see you every day.
Every day. Day after day. So, I think I put my hammer up here on this shelf. And, oh, new broom close by. Oh, cereal box right here in the cupboard. Oh, your teapot. Sweetie, what's this?
Sweetie, those are tea bags.
Sweetie, you should always take the tea bags out of the teapot.
Oh, but sweetie, Aunt Mildred always said you're supposed to leave them in. That way, the teapot gets a nice roasty flavor of tea over the years.
That's tannic acid. Tannic acid is really bad. You should always take the tea bags out of the teapot, sweetie. That's not good. That's bad.
Of course, sweetie. Not Aunt Mildred.
Anyway, I was thinking I'd put your teapot up here on this shelf.
Oh, I was thinking, sweetie, that we should put it in the cupboard.
In the cupboard? Okay.
Mm-hmm.
more shelves. Your things would fit here, and my things would fit here, but together they don't fit. Sweet, who? What's that?
It's my cigarettes, sweetie.
You know, smoke them.
Well, I didn't bother to tell you, Ernest, because I smoke maybe one cigarette a year on very cold nights.
Well, I guess you won't have to worry about that in this place. This old furnace really chucks out the heat.
I'll just put them away for that one nice cold winter night, sweetie.
I'll just put this empty box in the closet.
Oh, Ernest, I was thinking that we should keep all the coats on the coat rack and the sweaters in the sweater drawer.
What a good idea. Wait, where are you going with my jacket?
This is a sweater.
No. This is my good jacket.
Oh, isn't that funny? I was sure it was a sweater.
This is my good jacket. I've had it ever since I was in Boy Cubs with Mr. Garlic. I forgot you were here. Sorry. It's like a dream. I was thinking I could paint a window. This is my first basement home, and I think I'll miss the windows, but I think I could paint myself one. Sun streaming in. Rain. Lightning. Leaves. Changing colors. And the antelope. Free.
Oh, Ernest, I'm so lucky to meet a man like you.
Oh, me too, sweetie.
Ernest, I have something for you. For us. Close your eyes. No peeking. Now, come sit down.
Can I open my eyes now, sweetie?
Not yet, sweetie. Okay, you can open your eyes now.
Golly! Boy, oh boy. Would you look at that?
Do you like it, sweetie?
Yes! Yes, it's so darn colorful.
I like it because it doesn't pretend to be anything that it's not.
Oh. Look at that. Doesn't pretend. Just sits there. I won't have to water it.
No.
Won't ever grow. Won't ever change. Where are you gonna put it, sweetie?
Are you sure you like it, sweetie?
Yes! Yes! Yes!
Well, I was thinking that maybe it could go right here.
Well, now, would you look at that?
What?
There must be How many places are there in our basement home?
Oh, I don't know.
2,000! Over 2,000! And you picked the perfect spot.
Oh!
You are an artist, sweetie.
No, Ernest, you're the artist.
Oh, you have art in you.
Morning, sweetie.
Mm-hmm. Funky in the morning.
Morning, sweetie. Oh.
Yeah.
Was also like a dream. Don't get me wrong, it's still like a dream. It just makes me feel a little bit funny how Ernest just sits there in the morning reading the cereal. I would have thought that just one morning Ernest would jump up and walk me to the Woolworth's hat department. That's where I work. Don't get me wrong, I'm not complaining. Ernest is perfect. Just makes me feel a little bit funny how he just sits there. Like he's in a coma or something.
Ernestine? Ernestine is like, she's like a little sparrow. Flitting about the forest, flapping her wings, making little windy sounds. Flip flap, flip flap. Once I saw a golden osprey winging its way across the deep blue sky. And this little sparrow rose up out of the forest and started flitting all about the osprey, darting hither, thither, darted under the osprey and poked in its belly, and it poked in its head, and it poked in its eye. And the osprey slowly turned over, took that little sparrow in its talons, and squeezed its lipids. Answer that help wanted ad I saw outside of Farley's fish shop. Maybe I can start really, really early before Ernestine wakes up, and that way she can do what she has to do.
Ernest, I could read this man's poetry every day for the rest of my life. Oh, I love him.
Yeah!
Just
Just that it's time to go shopping now. We're supposed to go shopping now.
Where's the scotch tape, Ernest? We can fix this. Well, it took me a while to convince Ursula Scarf, my boss, that I should have the whole day off. I wanted to have lots of time to get ready for my special time with Ernest. I wanted to go to dinner and then to a movie, but as Ernest explained to me, the early bird always gets the fresh popcorn.
I was hurrying out of Farley's Tropical Fish Shop, where I work, to begin the homeward journey to Ernestine and our special time together, when I beheld one of nature's horrible wonders, a mother guppy in the throes of birth. I knew exactly what to do, and with calm and trembling hands, I netted that mother guppy and put her in the special mother guppy birthing tank. Now, as horrible as it may sound, mother guppies do have an insatiable and unforgivable desire to eat their babies. And as difficult as it may be, we must somehow come to grips with the dark and lasting truth that nature can sometimes be terrifying to perceive. This is just one example, and I'm sure you can think of others. But in the face of such mystery, I could hardly breathe. Anticipating the newborn baby guppy's free fall to safety, I stood and waited. What a dazzling spectacle it was! 27 baby guppies swimming free! And just as the 28th was being wrenched from its mother's womb, Farley, the owner of Farley's Tropical Fish Shop, came and told me in no uncertain terms to get the hell out of the store, Ernest! Now, as unforgivable as Farley's tone may have been, he had thankfully brought me face to face with the fact that my special time with Ernestine, to which I had sacredly avowed myself, was slipping away like sands on the beach of time. I leapt onto the homeward path and followed it rapidly.
special time together. When I notice a tiny object perched precariously atop the letter T of the second homeward stop sign. There, twittering in its confusion, was a ruby-crested nuthatch that had somehow, inexplicably, strayed at least 300 miles from its normal migratory flight path. I stood in silence, memorizing its characteristics and features so I could later record them in my boy cub bird identification book I had, given as a gift by Mr. Garlic. I was sure it was a ruby-crested nuthatch.
Ernest and I have a very special relationship. That's why I don't feel abandoned right now. In fact, I know that Ernest will be home very shortly. By the time I count to 10, Ernest will walk through that door. Watch. One. Two. Three. Four.
Just as the moment of positive identification was upon me, my bird bolted desperately away. I wheeled around to see that it was a man and a dog that had scared away my bird. A man and a seeing eye dog who appeared to be blind. The man, not the dog. Anyway, I was about to continue my homeward journey when I noticed the man do this. It was my feeling that this blind man was bluffing. So, in order to report him to the proper authorities, I followed him to the dark side of town, where I saw him cruelly strap his dog to a post outside of a bar. Well, I followed him into that bar just to give him fair warning of my intent to report. And it turns out he was a swell fellow, Sharky. Sharky told me this blind man's bluff was the only way he could keep his dog, his one true friend in the world. To show how much he loved that dog, he brought it out a pitcher of beer. Oh, I stood in awe as I watched the two of them wind their way home through the traffic. Oh, it's only then that I noticed it was dark. So I leapt onto the homeward path and I literally raced home to be with my Ernestine. Hi, sweetie, I'm home.
Ernest arrived home. He was 6 hours, 17 minutes, and 42 seconds. I watched him coming towards me. I don't know why, I've never noticed it before, but Ernest looks like a fish with his googly eyes and googly glasses. His hands like little fins. Ernest doesn't walk. He swims. I felt like I was going to explode. This time, I'm gonna let him have it. I'm gonna let him know just what it's like to be kept
2 seconds. I'm gonna pick him up and hurl him right through that stupid, ugly painted window and...
Ernest?
Sorry I'm late, sweetie. I couldn't help it.
That's okay, sweetie. I understand.
Probably too late to go out for dinner and a movie, but maybe we could go to the all-night variety and get a ginger ale or something.
That's a great idea, sweetie.
Okay. Let's go.
Sweetie.
Okay. Let's go.
Ernest, if we don't go right now, we'll miss last call for ginger ale.
Okay, let's go.
Ernest, just do me one little favor.
What?
Don't wear that sweater.
What?
I'd appreciate it if you wouldn't wear that stupid, ugly old sweater.
This is my good jacket! My audience!
Oh, it was awful.
It was really awful, Ernest. We came this close. Did your life pass in front of you?
Just the ugly parts.
God, it was that brick. That brick was the final straw. It just came.
No right to be there. None of it. It was really, really ugly.
Ernest, sit down.
Sit down, Ernestine. I want you to calm down.
If that highway department would put up their signs like they're supposed to, we would have known it was a one-way street. Right, Ernest?
Yeah.
How are we to know it was a one-way street? How are we to know?
There was an arrow pointing up. I saw an arrow pointing up.
What's that supposed to mean?
Oh, it means they botched it, Ernestine. All those people coming out of their homes yelling mean things at us. They botched it with that arrow sign, Ernestine.
That moving van coming down the wrong way. I guess it was coming down the right way, coming right at us. What choice did we have, Ernest? What choice?
No choice.
I think it was a children's playground we went through. Didn't you see that fence we crashed through?
Well, all I saw was a sign with a shadow of a child running free on a yellow triangle.
The highway department. It's just not fair. Ernest, we can sue them.
A little child with little stick legs and a little round head.
In fact, I think that's what we should do. We should write them a letter. Oh, this pen doesn't work.
Don't worry about the pen.
I want to write a letter. We have to write a letter. We came this close.
They had no right. It was ludicrous.
It's ludicrous what they do out there. That government is ludicrous.
Oh, we should write a letter. No, this pen doesn't work.
Don't worry about the pen. Just write.
To whom it may concern.
We were nearly killed.
No. To whom not it may. To whom it does concern.
That's good, Ernest. To whom it does concern.
Now I'm going to underline the does.
Yeah, that's good. Underline it 3 times and put an exclamation mark. We were nearly killed.
No. You nearly killed us.
No, you did.
Oh, to whom it better concern.
Yeah, that's good, Ernest. To whom it better concern. Yeah.
To whom it damn well better concern.
Or else, Ernest. Or fucking else.
To whom it damn well better concern or else.
Woo! That's good, Ernest. To whom it, write this down. To whom it fucking better concern or fuck off.
Fucking else. To whom it damn well better concern or fuck off.
Fuck you.
To whom it damn well fucking better concern or fuck off. Fuck you.
Both. Now.
Both.
Yeah.
Both.
Okay. That's good, Ernest. This is really good. Now, what comes next? We were nearly killed.
No. You nearly killed us.
You did. You tried to kill us. You.
Bastards.
Bastards. That's good, Ernest.
Bastards.
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 Just keep writing, Ernest. We don't want to miss any of the details.
Bastards.
The bricks.
Bastards.
The kids, the fence, the yelling.
You bastards fuck off.
Yeah, that's good. Keep it, Ernest.
You bastards can fuck right off.
You fucking bastards can fucking fuck right the fuck off. Too many fuckings, Ernest? Ernest, we only have one life to live, and they nearly took it away from us. Write that down.
I will.
No, I'm going to tell them. I'm going to go
right out there. No, go out there.
Ernest, I'm going out there because we're sitting here like dodos on a log.
You can't go out there.
I'm not going to sit here like a dodo on a log.
No, you can't.
Ernest.
What?
Oh, your face.
My face?
Yeah, your face. It's a bit squished in. Yeah, the fence. You got the imprint of the fence all over your face.
Does it look fine?
Oh, Ernest, I still love you.
You have no right to put a fence there.
Well, then you go out there and tell them.
Oh, you think I look ugly, don't you?
You don't look ugly. You just have a face that's a bit squished in.
I have a face that looks like a fence.
Ernest, we could sue them.
Those bastards. Yeah.
Ernest. Ernest!
What? What are you doing to me?
I'm not doing anything to you. I simply came into this inferno to find out if you've had any luck.
You yelled.
No, I did not yell.
You yelled at me.
Ernest, did it sound like I was yelling?
Yes, it did. Remarkably so.
Well, I'm sorry, sweetie. It's just that I can't quite believe that you still haven't figured out how to turn off that furnace.
It remains a grave mystery to me, sweetie.
Have you tried pulling the widget?
No, no, the widget has nothing to do with it.
I really think that we should try pulling the widget again.
Leave the widget completely out of it. The widget is a blind alley leading nowhere.
We have to do something, Ernest. This heat is unbearable. I'm melting, Ernest. I'm melting away to nothing. What are we gonna do, Ernest? What are we gonna do?
We're going to look at the book and the landlord left.
Oh, no, that stupid book. Why look at that stupid book? That book is stupid.
The book the landlord left is not stupid.
Fine. And suppose you tell me, Ernest, if the book that the landlord left is not stupid, then what is it?
What is what?
The book, Ernest. What is the book?
The book the landlord left is a step-by-step manual of maintenance or a temperamental heating device.
Then why doesn't it tell us how to turn it off?
That remains a major part of the mystery.
Oh, so it's not a stupid book. Maybe it's a mystery book. Oh, maybe it's a gothic novel. Just what are we gonna do, Ernest?
We're going to endure a difficult situation, and I suggest we do so without yelling.
How about melting, Ernest? How are we gonna endure it without melting?
Look, sweetie, I don't enjoy melting any more than you do. But just for a moment, think of the families that take their vacation at Disney World. Can you just for a moment try to think about them? What's wrong with you?
Ernest, why should I think about the poor people who take their holidays down in Disney World?
Sweetie, Disney World is in Florida.
I realize that Disney World is in Florida. What I want to know is how my thinking about the poor people who take their holidays down there is going to make me feel any better about melting away in a basement apartment with a man, with a book, with a furnace that won't turn off!
We have been prepared. This furnace has been chugging out the heat all winter long. And now it's the middle of summer and yes, it might seem hotter. It might even be hotter. But we have been prepared.
Ernest, what are you trying to say?
I'm saying, think of the northern Canadian school children. Year after year, dragged from their northern chilly homes down, down to the Florida sunshine.
Ernest, for God's sake, what are you saying?
I can't get my shirt off! I'm trapped! My 12th grade body's trapped in a tropical hell! The buttons are locked!
Ernest, stop it, come here.
You're doing something to me again! What are you doing to me?
I'll help you!
Oh, get away from me! Get away! Ah! Ah!
Oh, Ernest! Hi, Ernest.
Ah!
Oh, Ernest. Oh, let's go to the table. On the table, Ernest. Oh, Ernest, you have awakened something in me. I don't ever want to stop. I've always wanted to do it on the table.
Stop. On the table?
On the table, Ernest. Just let go.
On the table?
We can't stop now, sweetie.
On the table where I eat my breakfast? On the table?
I got confused. I thought we were in the bedroom.
You said you always wanted to do it on the table.
I said, let's keep doing it if we're able. Let's just go home.
You go to the bedroom. I'm gonna get something to eat. I haven't eaten in 3 days.
I'll come with you.
All right.
I'll just go freshen up.
Go to that new Chinese place up on the hill.
Anywhere you want, sweetie. Just not Chinese food. I don't feel like it somehow.
Me neither.
Why don't we could get a chicken dinner at the chicken ranch?
Oh, no, not chicken, Ernest. We always have chicken. It must be something other than chicken, Ernest. Anywhere you want, sweetie. Just use your imagination.
Hey, how about bingos?
A pizza place? We should go somewhere a little different, don't you think?
What's wrong with pizza?
I don't like it anymore.
You never told me that.
Just slipped my mind, Ernest. I forgot to tell you.
Well, what else have you forgotten to tell me?
Just decide where we're gonna go for dinner, Ernest.
I have decided. We're going to bingos. You can eat my crust.
Fine. We'll go to bingos.
Well, I don't want to go to bingos.
Just where do you want to go for dinner, Ernest?
I want to go to RJ's.
Fine, we'll go to RJ's. Anywhere. I'm hungry. We'll go have chicken. I'll have Chinese chicken at the pizza parlor, Ernest. Let's just go.
Are you okay?
I'm fine.
You sure?
I'm fine. Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm fine. Hey, you want to hear a joke?
Sure.
It's a good one. I saw it at RJ's last week. It was a graffiti. It said, Lassie is a bitch.
That's a good one.
I don't find that very funny.
What? Lassie is a bitch. It's a joke, sweetie.
I realize that it's a bit of a pun, but I don't find it funny. It's anti-women.
Sweetie, women have got nothing to do with it. It's a joke about a dog. Lassie is a bitch. It's true. That's what she is.
Yes, and women have been called bitches for centuries.
So have female dogs. That's what they are. They're bitches.
And that's why it's unpleasant to be referred to as a bitch.
No, but you see, it's not you that's the bitch. It's the dog, Lassie.
I realize that Lassie is a dog. Lassie, come home, Lassie. But the joke wouldn't be funny.
Oh, come on, sweetie. The joke is very simple. Lassie is a bitch. Bitch.
Called me a bitch.
Oh, I don't believe it.
Ernest, you just said.
What I just said
was. Oh, it's very clear to me what you just said.
What I just said, if you'll listen, is that Lassie is a bitch. Bitch. Emphasizing the word bitch. If I wanted to call you a bitch, I would have said it a little differently.
Oh, and how would that have been?
I don't know, maybe something like, Lassie is a bitch. Bitch. But that's not what I said.
Ernest. Little joke.
I don't want to call you a bitch.
No, come on, Ernest. Do what you want.
I don't. If you need I don't need to.
What's the matter? Are you afraid?
I'm not afraid. I'm not the towel.
Pig.
Slut.
Bastard.
Oh, you're like an animal. You can't get it enough.
That's because you don't give it enough.
How can I with you howling and drooling in my ear like a bitch in heat?
I fuck right off.
You fuck off.
Just fuck off, Ernest.
Fuck off.
Fuck off.
Fuck off. Fuck off. Fuck off. Fuck off. Fuck off.
Ernest,
I'd just like to take this opportunity to apologize to you. What you've been seeing isn't really me. I don't know who it is you have been seeing, but it isn't me. Like the other day. The other day in the supermarket, this sweet little woman came up to me and asked me where the tea bags are kept. And I said, in the teapot. God damn it. In the goddamn teapot! And I really enjoyed saying it. But it wasn't me who was enjoying it. It wasn't me. And Ernest isn't being Ernest. I'm sure there's a way of finding ourselves again. There must be. But until then, I've made a short little list of the words that Ernest should avoid using in my presence. Teabags. Tissue box. Table. Lassie.
I was reading about marriages in the pamphlets at the back of the church. It was there I think I read the words, you always hurt the one you love. Maybe it was a poem. It doesn't matter where. What's important is that I've been thinking about the words, you always hurt the one you love, and I've begun to wonder from time to time, who exactly is the you? Who is hurting who? I mean, I know Ernestine hurts me from time to time, unintentionally, of course. And I know I would never do a thing to hurt my Ernestine, but who exactly is the one who's always hurting the one you love? People shouldn't sing jolly little tunes about that. It's true. People should be prepared for that. Urgent messages sent out on a daily basis. You always hurt the one you love. Be prepared. Ernestine and I are. We prepared ourselves with a powerful and intricate pact. Ernestine, look at the judge!
Monkey picking peaches. Monkey picking peaches. Monkey picking peaches. Monkey picking peaches.
Ernestine, do you take this man to be your husband?
I do. Do you, Ernest, take this woman to be your wife?
I sure do.
That's just how he said it, too.
It's true.
Oh, this is gonna work like a charm.
It's those push-ups. When I do them, the anger just flows out my arms. Gone.
Ernest, I think that we should just explain. Okay. Ernest and I have decided that whenever we're really steamed up, when we feel like we're just gonna explode right through the roof, Ernest will call out, look at the judge! And then we'll go running to our squats.
But it doesn't always have to be me who says it. It could be either one of us.
But remember, sweetie, it was always going to be you who called and look at the judge, and then we'd go running to our quarters.
No, I don't remember that it was always going to be me who said it. What if I can't say it? Could be either of us.
Ernest, remember? I suggested it, and you agreed that we should keep the system simple, and it would always be you.
No, I don't remember that it would always be me, because what if I'm not able to say it?
Don't get amnesia.
amnesia now.
I'm not getting amnesia. Just what if I'm trapped and I'm locked and I can't say it? You should have as much responsibility as I.
You're being childish.
I am not being childish. Just what if I'm not able to say it?
This is the one rule that I've made up in this apartment.
Ernestine.
What?
You cannot make up rules.
You make up rules all the time.
Oh, I most certainly do not.
Ernest.
Listen, Ernestine. There is a natural existing order to things. And if you interpret that order correctly, you have a rule.
Ernest, this isn't some boy cub field trip with Mr. Garlic. We're talking peace here, between you and me.
I am talking peace, but you have as much responsibility for keeping the peace as I.
You're doing this to provoke me.
I'm not doing this to provoke you. Listen to the fucking judge. Shut up and do your fucking monkey business.
Monkey picking peaches.
Excuse me.
Christine, do you take this man to be your husband?
I do. Do you, Ernest, take this woman to be your wife?
Sure I do.
That's not how you said it. You kiss me now. Ernest, you have to kiss me.
I can't kiss you. Ernestine!
Ernest!
Look at the judge.
Monkey picking peaches.
Ernestine, do you take this man to be your husband?
I do. Do you, Ernest, take this woman to be your wife?
I sure do. You hate me, don't you?
What?
You hate me, don't you? Don't you?
Ernest, what's wrong?
I'll tell you what's wrong. You threw away my jacket, you left the tea bags in the teapot, you left the tissue box on the table, and now my hammer is missing. Why do you hate me?
Ernest, just calm down.
I don't want to calm down.
Ernest, just let's sit down.
I don't wanna let's just sit down. I wanna know why you hate me.
Ernest, I'm sorry if you can't find your sweater.
It's a jacket!
Ernest.
It's a goddamn jacket!
Ernest, would you just
let me say that I wouldn't dream of touching your smelly old sweater.
It's not a sweater, it's a jacket!
And I've never seen your hammer. I don't believe it exists.
It exists!
And the tea bag should stay in the teapot. And the tissue box looks better right here! Stay where you are, don't come near me!
Oh, don't worry, Ernestine, I wouldn't dream of coming near you. In fact, I'm not even gonna look at you until you apologize to me.
You're right, Ernest. I should apologize.
Will you forgive me? It's just that I feel so inadequate next to you. That was terrible, how I came home in such a mousy way. It's just so hard to measure up to your dramatics. Can I try it again, sweetie? This time I promise I'll be more like Liz Taylor! We can make a movie out of it, Ernest. That'll be fun. We'll put the lights out there and the cameras back here by the tissue box. You'll love this, Ernest, because you'll get to say, you hate me, don't you? Don't you? Just like you did before. It's so exciting being greeted like that. Quiet on the set. We'll call the movie King Tut Ernest and his 210 commandments. Quiet on the set! Lights, cameras, action. King Tut Ernest, alone on his mountaintop, looks down over his empire and feels sad because one of his subjects disobeyed his rule about leaving the tea bags in the teapot. Just then, his most pathetic wife, Queen Ernestine, enters his chamber. I'm gonna have to rehearse this bit just a little, sweetie, because I'm just a stupid wife and not a great actor like you. I look up at you, feeling sick, sick with guilt, because it was me. I admit it. It was me who left the tea bags in the teapot. I crawl to you. No, 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 no. Crawling is too good for me. I slither to you on my belly like the worm that I really am. And if I could get any lower, Ernest, really, I would. I clutch at your long white jacket slash robe, which I shamefully mistook to be a sweater.
Say that.
Ernest, don't. I said.
What are you really saying?
All right, Ernest.
is your fault. That's what you wanted me to say, and it's true. It's all your fault.
It's all my fault.
It's all your fault.
Fault. It's all my
all
fault.
Your
it's all my fault.
It's all
my fault.
Ernest, I think I know why this is all happening.
Suppose you tell me why, Ernestine.
Well, the problem is, it's because...
What?
It's because I feel judged by you.
Well, that is a problem, because I know for a fact that I don't judge you.
Yeah, but Ernest, I feel judged.
But I do not judge you.
I don't know, Ernest, is something.
Listen,
you
I just
do.
Said I don't judge you.
Yes, but Ernest, I feel.
Well, then your
judged.
Feelings are false because I don't.
Are you calling me a liar?
No.
And I don't know my
I'm
own
I'm just saying
feelings.
You're feeling falsely because.
What are my feelings?
What about my feelings?
You don't have any.
I really hurt my hand.
No, you shouldn't have hit the furnace, Ernest!
Really, really hurt.
I'm sorry, Ernest.
I'm sorry.
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 I'm sorry. I had this dream the other night about you, Ernest. I dreamt that your ears fell off. And I said to you, Ernest, put your ears back on. And you said, what's that, Ernestine? I can't hear you. My ears fell off. So I said, Ernest, put your ears back on. And you said, what's that, Ernestine? I can't hear you. My ears fell off. Ernest, put your ears back on. What's that, Ernestine? I can't hear you. My ears fell off. So I finally gave up. And I put your ears in my purse. And I woke up feeling very, very tired.
I always thought that there was a natural existing order to things. And if you interpreted that order correctly, you had a rule. But Ernestine, you make up rules all the time. I guess that does something to the old natural existing order. So I've started seeing rules everywhere I go. At RJ's, I saw a rule. It was a good one. It said, if it feels good, do it. But what if it doesn't feel good? What if it feels really, really bad? So I made up a rule. It's my first one. It goes, feels bad? Kill it. Kill it. I hate you, Ernestine.
I hate you, Ernest.
Bang!
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 Thank you.
could... I could...
Just say it, Ernest.
I hate you.
I hate you. Because you never let me in. Into your own stupid little world.
I hate you because you never stop moving, turning, changing. You're changing me, Ernestine. Stop changing me. Stop wrecking things. You wreck my breakfast, you wreck my marriage, you wreck everything!
I hate going step by step all the time! I wanna run!
Then run! But let me go slow!
I'm not perfect! I don't wanna be perfect!
I hate you because I hate not knowing what to say to you!
I hate you because I'm afraid to say things to you!
I hate you because you say things that aren't true!
I hate you because of the things you don't say!
Like what?
Like I can fix the furnace, Ernest! Why can't you say that?
You fixed the furnace and you didn't even know what you were doing.
I hate it because you can never admit that I'm right.
I hate it. I hate it because I'm stupid. And now you know it.
Ernest, I'm the one who's stupid.
You're not stupid.
Then why do you make me feel stupid?
Because I'm afraid of you.
What?
I'm afraid.
So am I. You look funny.
Where's my hat?
I love your hat.
I love your hat.
You do? Mm-hmm.